Namaste. Namaste. Can you all hear me okay? And see the slides as well.
Yes.
Thank you. Om Shri Ganeshaya Namaha. Om Shri Sarasvatyaya Namaha. Om Shri Gurubhyo Namaha. Sabhayai Namaha. Shri Krishna Paramatmane Namaha. Gita Matre Namaha. Salutations to the Lord of remover of obstacles. Salutations to the Goddess of knowledge. And salutations to all our teachers in our profession and those who touched our lives at every stage of our life. And salutations to you all for joining today and sparing your precious time with us. Saluting Lord Krishna and the text Gita, let's enter into the second of the 3-day session. This Bhagavad Gita was not taught under a tree. Was not taught in a palace. And it was not taught in a school, nor virtually via Zoom, but it was taught in a war field. There are two great teachings which happened in the war field and which led to instant success, from crisis to confidence. From a pitiable situation to a meritorious condition, a victorious situation. And that is Aditya Hridayam by Sage Agastya to Rama. And we see that in Ramayana. And this great text, Bhagavad Gita. And may I request everyone to mute, please. So we have seen few important aspects yesterday. Not to run after search for happiness, but knowing that happiness is us, happiness is in us, and happiness is one thing which is our innate nature, knowing that we should happily go around. And we also have seen the spirit of yajna, the teamwork. Every profession knows the importance of teamwork, but more so the medical profession. There is no success without involving every person and every team member, whether it is in acute resuscitation or in a palliative care or in management of a chronic condition. And we also learned we should not act with reaction, but act with reflection. Action and vision concomitantly. We've seen this great definition of yoga, samatvam, equipoise, equanimity, is defined as yoga. Shri Krishna revolutionized the definition of yoga with these statements. Samatvam yoga uchyate, the equipoise, the equanimity. Swami Ranganathananda says, the homeothermy, we are all homeothermic animals. Now the snakes are pycholothermic. Homeothermy, we maintain our temperature, body temperature, and all the hormonal and emotional status. But especially when we compare to the homeothermy of the body, it is a God-given gift. But homeothermy of the mind is something, a picture perfect, we should strive for, we should aim for. And when we do that with practice, keeping a higher goal, that is kausalam, the skill and the dexterity at work, yoga karma sukausalam. This is what we have learned over a number of years after the initial first couple of years of theoretical bookish knowledge. And we have taken books to the wards, to the hospitals, to the clinics, to the operating theaters. And imagine the skill which was taught to us with practice we gained. Imagine those super specialists, the cardiac catheterization, balloon angioplasties, interventional radiology, the microsurgery. And we've also seen a few examples like how to withdraw when we see a perturbing, disturbing situation like a tortoise, developing the equipoise. And we have seen the sequential destruction, the sequential spiral ladder, which starts with an anchoring, irresistible desire, leading to anger if it is not fulfilled, and then from anger to total destruction. And we have seen that the four divisions of labor, and we found the dignity of labor and how to respect. In second chapter, there is something which is focused, is vyavasayatmika buddhi, a focused mind, mindfulness, keeping one goal. And we all have strived for it. We worked for it. We wanted to become what we became. So that vyavasayatmika buddhi, that nischayatmika buddhi, that ananya buddhi, that avyabhicharini buddhi. Vyabhicharini, the one which goes in every different directions. Avyabhicharini, the focused mind. So the mindfulness, the focus, the one idea, one specialization, or being in the field that you love to cherish your life. So Swami Vivekananda says this very profoundly. Take up one idea. Make that one idea your life. Think of it. Dream of it. Live on that idea. Let the brain, muscles, nerves, every part of your body be full of that idea. And just leave every other idea alone. So many nights we have spent like this, with books, with patients, in the hospitals. This is the way to success. And this is the way great spiritual and great professional giants are produced. Others are mere talking machines. Bhagavad Gita is divided into three parts. The 18 chapters. A Virat Kohli's number, as you know, is 18. So there are 18 chapters with 700 verses. So remember James Bond 007. So if you actually read it backwards, it's a 700 verses. And bond, Bhagavad Gita says, break all the bonds. And James and Bhagavad Gita tells us to go beyond the name and form in the 12th chapter, if we can. And most of you might have heard this Mahavakya, the great, great word and sentence. Sentences when there is more than one word. So here, there are three words put together. Tattvamasi. Tattvamasi is made up of three words. Tat, Tvam, Asi. Thou art that. Tat means that. Tvam is thou, you and me. Asi are. That is you. You are that. Thou art that. So first six chapters, we have seen to a greater extent dealing with you and me, thou. Now these second six chapters mainly deal with that. So that is that supreme consciousness. You may call it God, Paramatma, Brahman, consciousness, divinity, primordial energy, or the force. May the force be with you, we say. So that. We do not know what to call that. So we just said that. Because it is so grand, because of its grandeur nature, we call it Brahman. So Brahman means Brihatvat, because it is so grand. We cannot grasp it. So 18 chapters, 1700 verses. And then each of these six chapters constitute three shatkas. Shatka means the one which has six. So six chapters. The first one is called Karma Yoga. The second shatka, this chapter 7 to chapter 12, is called Bhakti. Bhakti Shatka. So Karma Shatka, Bhakti Shatka, and then comes the joining of these two. How can we bring these together in life? How can we bring action and vision together? How can we bring action and reflection together? So that is taught in the third six chapters, that is Jnana Shatka. Bhagavad Gita is divided into four yogas also. And the yogas are Karma Yoga, Bhakti Yoga, Dhyana Yoga. So Dhyana Yoga can be part of contemplation, is part of both Karma and Bhakti. And Jnana Yoga, the Yoga of Knowledge. What does Yoga mean? Most of us know what Yoga means is the stretching of the body. But that's not just yoga. There is much more to yoga. Yoga means a union with God. It arises, it takes its root from the word yuj, yoke, y-o-k-e, yoke, the yoke which connects the two bulls, you know, while ploughing. Yoga means to unite with God. Yoga means uniting all and connecting with all, yet detaching from all, but attaching to one's own will. All-inclusiveness is a key to success in our teamwork, in our profession. Yoga means equity in interaction, equipoise in every action, dexterity and skill in each expression. Yoga means self-control, constant self-patrol, self-regulating will. Yoga means restraining thoughts, chitta vritti nirodha, as Patanjali says. Retraining our thoughts, streamlining thoughts, and calmness of our mind in acts. It means readiness for action, not going into the caves, but steadiness in action and steadfastness, the sthita prajna lakshana, as we have seen in action. Ability in mobility, stability in mobility, and moderation is a mantra of adoration. We have seen that yukta ahara viharasya, yukta chestasya karmasu, yukta swapna avabodhasya yogo bhavati dukkha. Yoga means evolution in life, elegance in work, eloquence in speech, moving from ego space to live in eco space. Otherwise, we are called sthena. Sthena means chore, if you don't give back. Yoga means convincing gesture, comfortable posture, living the values and virtues. It so much matters when you talk to the patient, your gesture. It's just not your words. 30% is with your vocabulary and words, but 70% is with gesture. Most of the patients, most of the family members, if you ask them when they were in desperate situation, with a dying patient when you're dealing with them, they do not remember the 30 minutes of talk you did, but they remember that gentle, humane touch of your hand. Yoga means controlling our senses, which are like horses, conquering anger force and other internal force. We have seen that as the chariot metaphor yesterday. Yoga means reveling in joy, joyously expressing the work, not expecting joy at work. Don't go around expecting the joy at work, but go happily around expressing the joy at work. We talked about the importance of smile as Krishna, Prahasanniva Bharata. Pursuit of excellence with belief in progress, joy and peace, justice and happiness. Living childlike, not being childish. If we are like childish, we are foolish. If we are childlike, that is the expression of the bliss in us, the maturity in us. Yoga is working with focus, with self as a locus for self-purification and world glorification. Atmano moksha-artham jagat hitayacha. For our progress and the glory of the world. Yoga means a selfless action with utmost devotion and constant contemplation. Bringing the personality within us from the yoga mat to the office seat. Knowledge of action and knowledge in action. Seeing action in action. That masterly inactivity, as we have seen yesterday, and inaction in the action. So it is detachment from attachment to sorrow. Hakuna Matata. Hakuna Matata. This poem I wrote after getting inspired by Swami Bodhananda's talk on yoga. Sir Robert Hutchison, he calls his a pitiable state that we don't want to be in. From inability to let well alone. Always we are itching to do something. But that masterly inactivity, karmanya karmaya pashet, akarmanicha karmayaha. So not doing anything and doing little is also doing the most. As Sir William Osler says, a young doctor thinks of 20 different medications for one condition, whereas a mature doctor thinks of one medication for 20 different conditions. From too much of zeal for the new and contempt for what is old. You may say that this Bhagavad Gita was taught 5,000 years ago, but it is sanatana, purana, pura api nava iti. Even though it is ancient, it is so pertinent even today, as you are seeing. For putting knowledge before wisdom. Knowledge is jnana, wisdom is vijnana. Science before art, and cleverness before common sense. From treating patients as cases, we have to see the divinity in everyone, each one. Rogi is Daridra Narayana and Rogi Narayana. So see the divinity in the patient, and from making the cure of the disease more grievous than endurance of the same, O Lord, deliver us. Knowledge and wisdom. The seventh chapter is called Vijnana Yoga or Jnana Vijnana Yoga. Knowledge we can know from textbooks, from YouTube, from lectures, but the wisdom is something which comes with experience, with maturity. And we have to be it. Wisdom has simplicity to it. And we have talked about this tattvamasi, tattvamasi. So here, this is Dunning-Kruger effect. When we do not know anything, our confidence level is so low. And when we know something, as we were the young, dynamic residents, the peak of confidence, it mounts sometimes to stupidity. And we have seen many of mentors smiling at us for our energetic, enthusiastic, and sometimes stupid activity. And then when we know more, our confidence level goes down because knowledge is like a spear. Dr. Somaraju first told me about this. Blaise Pascal, a French physicist, he said this, knowledge is like a spear. The greater its volume, the larger is its contact with the unknown. So take a small circle, and the outside of which is not known to you, but the inside of which is what is known to you. And imagine, take a big circle, you know more, but the contact with unknown outside is also more. And that's when you see the experience teaches you. There is some slope of enlightenment happening in our lives. So where the knowledge increases, the confidence increases. But here are the mentors, the gurus, teachers, the most experienced professors who taught us, taking their mission for their lifetime just to only educate us. So where their knowledge is at its peak, confidence is at its peak. And that's where a stable personality, a mature personality is shown. So what is karma? Work. What is bhakti? The devotion. And what is knowledge? Rajaji, Rajagopalachari, Chakravarti Rajagopalachari, he says this way, the way of devotion is not different from the way of knowledge or jnana. When intelligence matures and lodges securely in the mind, it becomes wisdom. When wisdom is integrated with life and issues out in action, it becomes bhakti. I shall repeat. When wisdom is integrated with life and issues out in action, it becomes bhakti. Knowledge, when it becomes fully mature, is bhakti. If it does not get transformed into bhakti, such knowledge is useless tinsel. To believe that jnana and bhakti, knowledge and devotion, are different from each other is ignorance. And he gives the example of Adishankara himself and his great small poem, Bhajagovindam. And bhakti, again, bhakti, yoga, karma, dharma, these are the words which cannot be translated into English, but we have some loose translation, so that's all we have to go by. So bhakti comes from bhaj. Bhaj is an unconditional love. Parama prema swarupa towards that supreme. And it is amrita swarupa. It is like nectarine in nature. And having reached that state, you don't want anything else. Yam labdhva puman siddho bhavati amrito bhavati trupto bhavati. You're very content. And one of the famous verses from 7th chapter goes like this. Manushyanam sahasreshu kaschiti yatati siddhaye yatatamapi siddhanam kaschin mam vetti tattvataha. You and I are one in a million. Imagine how many are striving to become the doctors and how many got the opportunity. And how many got this message that there is this class today, but how many of us could attend? It went to 1,000+ members. So one in 1,000, one in 1,000,000 get this opportunity to know about ourselves, to know about the life and the Lord. I'm not belittling anyone who is not attending. I'm sure that everyone has their own predicaments and their own commitments. So who knows the music? Child knows the music. Shishur vetti. An animal knows. Cows. Pashur vetti. The cobra knows. Vetti gana rasampani. And who knows the Lord and the life? One in 1,000,000. Who strives for it knows. And in the 7th chapter, we are given a glimpse of the world, of the environment around us, to appreciate the essence of the nature, the greatness of the nature, the auspiciousness in every aspect of the world, to see the happiness sprouting, oozing out of this. When you drink a glass of water, Sadhguru says, look at the water. Let it settle for a while. Just don't drink right away from the tap. Let all the bubbles settle. Let the perturbations in that water settle. And treat it as an individual. Rasoham apsu kaunteya. Then you shall taste the water. The taste is the prime nature of the water. And gandha, the smell, is the prime nature of the Mother Earth. Some of you might have, especially the pregnant woman, might have sensed that smell of the earth after the first rain, as it happened a couple of days ago and today for us in Texas. And then that splendor in sun, and that pleasant light which comes out of the moon. And that pleasure we all got when we landed on the moon, Chandrayaan. And that seed in everyone, and the intellect among the intellectuals like Einstein, is me, O Arjuna, says Lord Krishna. And he talks about the four different personalities. Yesterday we have seen 9 different personalities. Suhrun mitrar yudasin madhyastadveshya bandhushu sadhushvapi cha papeshu samabuddhir vishishyate. How to treat each one optimally and how to see the divinity in everyone, in a friend, in a foe, in a great person, in a janitor, in a relative, in someone who hates you. And here, there are 4 kinds of people who approach us. The one who is afflicted, who is in miserable condition, either physically or mentally, or the one who just tries to interact with you to see what you are up to, what you are up to. And there's someone who approaches you with a secondary interest. There is a secondary gain. But there are some who touch your life with no other agenda. No other agenda. So these are Chaturvidha Bhajante Mam Jana Sukriti Norjuna Artho Jignyasur Arthaarthi Jnani Cha Bharatarshava. Then we go to the 8th chapter. 8th chapter is called Akshara Parabrahma Yoga or Abhyasa Yoga. It teaches us how to leave this world. All other chapters deal with how to live in this world. As Swami Chinmayananda says, 8th chapter deals with how to leave from this world. If we can practice 1 mantra, that is Om. Swami Dayananda says, God has no name or form, like it is said in Islam. But if you have to give 1 name to the Lord, to the God, that is Om. And God is what? G-O-D, the generator, the operator, and the dissolver. Srishti Sthiti Laya, the creation, sustenance, and dissolution, under whose power these 3 are. So that is the God. And it is said with 1 simple word, which is made up of 3 alphabets, that is A, U, Ma. Om, the insignia of unknown and the icon of unseen. Om, the means to reach our goal, and also the goal for us all. It is a sound that is empowering, the sound that is encompassing, the sound that is ever enlivening, the sound that is enthralling, the sound which all Vedas propound, the sound which all austerities resound, the sound which all ascetics expound, the sound that is primordial and profound. Om ityekaksharam brahma. So that is Om, ekaksharam. And this is what all Vedas say. Yadaksharam veda vido vadanti vishanti yadyatayo vitaragah yadichanto brahmacharyam charanti tatte padam sangrahena pravakshe. O Arjuna, I shall teach all that succinctly, with brevity, putting the entire nature and entire lyrics and entire knowledge into one word. That which involves the whole, imbibes the zeal, invokes the soul, ensures the wheel, envelops all our scriptures and epics, unfolds all our knowledge and lyrics. But it is not that easily understood, that easily experienced. We have to practice abhyasa yoga. Abhyasa yoga yuktena chetasa nanyagamina. So that with mind not going, not wavering anywhere, and with practice, like the oil in sesame seed, like the butter in yogurt or curd, like the water in a riverbed, like the fire in firewood, it is only revealed and revered. It is recognized and experienced when one practices with a fixed mind beyond this mundane world. See the effect of chant of the Om. And it is scientifically proven. When you chant, so the amygdala is activated. There's so many endorphins produced in our body. The nervousness, the anxiety, the adrenergic surge, the epinephrine release, and all these are subdued. And there comes a nice state of bliss when you chant this. If you don't want to chant Om, if you think that it is more religious, just do some Brahmari. Just close your nose and ears and mouth and then try to say this. NASA has shown that the sound produced in the solar region is nothing but this Om. So, Om iti ekaksharam brahma. If you can practice this, and if you can say this, Vyaharan mamanismaran yaprayati tyajandeham sayati paramam gatim. So, if you can say this one word while we are departing this body, but is that easy? Gandhiji could say, Hey Ram at the end, but how many times he did think of Ram? So, the last moments, we may be on ventilator with the tubes, with the lines, with the sedation, and under the effect of all medications. We cannot remember. So we have to ensure right now. Yam yam vapis maran bhavan tyajatyante kalevaram tam tame vaiti kaunteya sada tad bhava bhavita amta kale cha mameva smaran muktva kalevaram yap prayati samadbhavam yati nastyatra samshaya. If you think of something, you become something. If you think of the ultimate, you reach the ultimate. And the time matters. The time is talked about. What time of the day, of the month, of the year is good for departing? But this is one thing that you believe in. But there is a more philosophical and spiritual meaning of this. This Agni, Jyoti, Ahaha, Shukla, so the daytime, the 6 months where the sun moves northbound, these are all called Shuklagati. But if you look at philosophically and spiritually, when you depart this body with fire of knowledge, with the light of knowledge, with prakasha of the daytime light, that is when we actually reach that Brahmapadam, that ultimate abode. In other words, again, the Krishnagati, dhumo, smoky, ratri, dark. So the ignorance is the darkness, smokiness, the fuzziness with doubts. So all that will only pull us down. So this is what it is. And there are some patients, some of you, when you are dealing with, they want a particular time for an important surgery, or when you have to redirect the care. And I'm a neonatologist. I have come across a couple of moms who wanted a C-section on a particular day. If it is elective, yes. But one night, there was chorioamnionitis, and then she was pleading with everyone to wait until next day. So I had to go and then convince right here. And he said, I asked why, oh, Friday is a good day. And I said, it is Friday in India and Thursday here, but Friday in India, so go for it. And she went for it, and the baby and mother were fine. So time matters to some. Then, what is this creation? Why are we here? How did we come here? When did we come here? And what for? Who brought us here? By whom? Kena. So all these are answered in our Upanishads and also is alluded to in Bhagavad Gita. How do all these bhutas, the beings, come? Sarva bhutani kaunteya prakritim yanti mamikam kalpakshaye punastani kalpadav visrajamyaham. It is going on for ages, the creation, for millennia, coming and going. It is anadi. We cannot find its origin. Stephen Hawke, he gave many talks. I was fortunate to attend one of his talks. He talks to the extent where the scientific mind can see and analyze, but still there are no answers. And Swami Vivekananda says, spirituality begins where science ends. So there are a few things which science cannot answer. So this prakriti and purusha, the consciousness is purusha, the energy, and prakriti, the matter, coming together. And avasham prakriter vashat. So this is happening involuntarily and without our involvement. And it is going on for ages. And there is that consciousness controlling. Prakritim swamadhishtaya sambhavami atma mayaya. Prakritim swamavastabhya visrajami punah punah bhutagramam imam krishnam avasham prakriter vashat. Then, having come here, we can never answer whether egg came first or chick came first, whether seed came first or the tree came first. Sapiens is one book which is worth reading everyone in medical field. So he talks about the origin, evolution, but does not touch upon this. He doesn't go into this. So beyond sapiens is this, the divinity, the divine vision. When we search within ourselves, koham, who am I, who am I? And we have seen yesterday, we are not just this body, naham, deham. Then who am I? Soham, I am that, I am that. And when shall we realize that? When we surrender ourselves, as Arjuna did, karpanya doshopa hataswabhaha swabhavaha. Karpanya doshopa hataswabhavaha pruchhamitvam dharma sammodha chetah yachreyasya nischitam bruhitanme shishyasteham shadhimam tam tvam prapannam. So when we say dasoham, Krishna being chor, he will take away da from it and give us the experience of soham, saha, aham. I am him, I am that. And this evolution, this existence is made up of nine things. Out of that, eight we can clearly see. The five, very gross. Bhumi rapo nalo vayuhu kammano buddhirevacha ahankara iti yamme bhinna prakriti rasthada. Bhumi, the earth. So we are going from gross to subtle. So gross to subtle. Let us see. So this flute with the holes you see here. So bhumi, earth. Apaha, the waters. Analaha, the fire. Vayu, the wind god. The air. Then kam, the akasha. So these five elements we know. And we are made up of these five elements. And they are manas, that is subtle. We know that we have a mind, the one which wavers. Then we have buddhi, nischayatmika buddhi. Chanchalam manas. But nischayat, the determination, the discriminating buddhi. And then that ego within us, ahamkara. So these are subtle. So these are ashtavidha prakriti. Eightfold nature. But there is a ninth one because of which we are upheld. And that is like the string in a pearl. Apareyamitastvanyam prakritim vidhime param jiva bhutam mahabaho yayedam dharyate jagat. That string is holding everything. Matta parataram nanyat kinchidasti dhananjaya mayi sarvamidam protam sutre manigana iva. And when we know this, there is something more that we are in this world, deluded with ignorance, acting the way we acted and we act sometimes. But how to surpass this? And this is called the ignorance, maya, avidya. Then how to go beyond this? Daivi hesha gunamayi mama maya duratyaya mame vaye prapadyante maya me tam tarantite. This maya is made up of three gunas, sattva, rajas and tamo. We'll deal with that tomorrow in detail. And how to go beyond this? So this maya is like the fishnet. And we are all the fish. We are all the fish. And what is the safest place for the fish? The fishnet is thrown. If you run away, you are caught in the fishnet. Like a rat race, if you are running and running and running after. But if you find that locus with focus, at the feet of the fisherman, you are so safe. The fishnet is not going to catch the fish. So that is the key to find who we are, what we are, how can we become that. And how do people worship? They worship any of the many forms. So respect all religions. Respect each one's opinions. Mata. So jitne matte utne path. So many faiths and so many paths. Jnana yajnena chapyanye yajanto mamu pasate ekatvena pruthatvena bahudha visvato mukham. The same one is in all. One, there are not many. So God is one. But the learned say in many different ways. So that, ekam satta, then vipra bahudha vadanti. So we worship ekatvena, pruthaktvena, Rama, Krishna, Devi, and Shakti, and so on. Or you see the divinity in humanity, the God in the world. So many deities, many idols, many vigrahas, and you see the universal form and the universe in the God. God in the universe will come to that. But we are striving and going after two things. One is yoga and kshema. Yoga is attaining or procuring what we don't have. Kshema is retaining or securing what we already have. So all our worry, all our hurry is to attain something what we don't have. And that is hurry. And our worry, retaining or securing what we already have, or the worry of losing what we already have. But if we act with this attitude, surrendering unto Him, that supreme power, whomever you consider as your Ishtadevata, as something which is driving you, the supreme consciousness, then ananya chintayanto mam yejana pariyupasate tesham nityabhiyuktanam yogakshemam vahamyaham. I shall take care of them. And there is another great verse in the ninth chapter. It goes like this. Patram pushpam phalam toyam yo me bhaktya prayachati. I shall accept whether it is a leaf, whether it is a flower, whether it is a fruit, or even a glass of water. But there is much more to it. How can you apply in your daily life? So give some tips. Give some bonus to your employees. Surprise them on a Christmas day, on a holiday, or for no reason. And say thank you for something which may look trivial. And give someone a bouquet of flowers. Bring some fruits to your staff. If not anything, just offer some water to your patients. And to the divinity, there's a little bit more to that. Patram is the body, which is like a leaf which falls one day. Pushpam, flower, is the flower of our knowledge. The knowledge flowers as we mature. Fruit of our action, the result of our action. And tears of pure love. This is what that Supreme Consciousness superpower wants. The 10th chapter and the 11th chapter. The 10th chapter is Vibhuti Yoga, seeing the God everywhere, seeing the glory everywhere. And 11th chapter is seeing the world in God. So God in the world is 10th chapter. World in the God is Vishwarupa, 11th chapter. Swami Chinmayananda says, 10th chapter is audio version, 11th chapter is a video version. This is seeing divinity everywhere, in everything and every time, as one of my friends, Anup, says. So, but it is not that easy to imbibe and inculcate. We have this external projection with all our predicaments, and the internal reflection is what is needed. So the glories are expressed, the sparks and the grandeur is seen in humans, demons, kings, saints, animal kingdom, plant kingdom, the text, the knowledge, perceptible, imperceptible. I shall just give few examples. Humans, naranam cha naradipam, among all the humans, I am the leader. I am the prime minister, like Narendra Modi. Among the demons, Prahlada chasme daityanam. Prahlada may be born as a demon in a demon clan, but how great was he? We all know. And among all the munis, saints, I am Vyasa. We owe him a lot. Animal kingdom, Ruganam cha Mrugendroham. I am the lion among the animals. Ashwattha sarva vrikshanam. Tomorrow we'll see the tree, Ashwattha, the people tree among all the trees. Text, Vedanam Samavedosmi. The Samaveda, all the music comes from this Samaveda, so pleasing to the ears. So then, Adhyatma Vidya Vidyanam. Of all the texts, we have seen from Grey's Anatomy to Robinson to Harrison to Billy and Love and all. And now we are leaning towards one text. So that is Adhyatma Vidya, Bhagavad Gita. And all these are his vibhutis. Buddhi, intellect. Jnanam, the knowledge. Then asammoha, lack of delusion. Kshama, the tolerance, the pardoning nature. Satyam, the truthfulness. Dhamma, the control of our senses. Shama, the control of our mind. All these are vibhutis, the glories of the Supreme Consciousness. Abhayam, the fearlessness. Even bhayam, the fear. We have to be afraid of few things. And tushti, the contentment. And dhanam, the charity, the nature to give and share and care. So sharing and caring. All these are his vibhutis. His vibhutis. Then Lord concludes this 10th chapter saying, Antate kathayishyami divya hyatma vibhutaya. There are so many, so many. I shall tell you only very few. And he narrates 70 or so. Then tells Arjuna, O Arjuna, just know that this entire world is pervaded by a spark of mine. And we know that. We know that what we know and what we see, the scientists see, is only a part of so much that we do not know the black hole. Then Lord says, I am the moon among all stars. Nakshatra Nama Hamsashi. I just wanted to put this to celebrate the success of our Chandrayaan. So if Krishna had to say now a few examples, I have given those examples, Uchchaisravasam, among the horses, I am that Uchchaisravas. Uchchaisravas means all of you with the erect and attentive ears. You see the horse ears, how erect they are? So the one that with power of listening is me. So here are the Lord's words in this modern world. So he would say probably, of all basketball players known, I am Michael Jordan, well known. Among the tennis players, I am Roger Federer or Djokovic, the super player. I am Sachin Tendulkar, the little master, the greatest cricket player ever. Among the politicians and the spokesmen, I am ever charming Bill Clinton. Dyutam Chalayatam Asmi. And the Lord says that I am that game of dice among all the games. Among the poets in modern era of East and West, I am Tagore and Shakespeare the best. Among the men of science and intelligence, I am Albert Einstein, who knew the essence. Among all Greek philosophers, I am the great sage Socrates. Among all practitioners of nonviolence, I am Gandhi, who walked in flesh not long ago on this earth. Of all the travelers who went far and long, I am famous, that astronaut known as Neil Armstrong. Of all the cities with diversity, I am Las Vegas, the Sin City. Dyutam Chalayatam Asmi, that's where the game of dice goes. Among all the games in the college these days, I am the football game on Fridays. Of all the incarnations of peace and kindness, I am the Son of God, Jesus. And there is much more in store. Among all the Hindu texts sacred, I am Gita, the celestial song of the Lord, the epic text. He can go on and on. But these are only a few examples, few glimpses. One should look up to, one should aim to become too. They have the divine spark, a bit more than the rest. They shine with their hard work and live at their best. Their human effort is magnified by the divine effect. It's the glory of God, reflection of God, the endless, the countless, the limitless, and doubtless. So we have to keep them as role models. When we see the divinity, the spark of the divinity in these great, we start seeing the greatness, the simplicity in the simple people as well. The simple people as well. So this cannot be seen with human eye. We have to be given the divine vision. We know that we can see. We say, I see. When we are closing our eyes, when something is distant, we see, I see. We say, I see. Natumam shakyase drastum anenaiva svachakshusha divyam dadamite chakshuhu pashyame yogamaishwaram. I shall give that divine vision, O Arjuna, to you, with which you can see this divinity everywhere. And when that vision comes with his grace and with our longing, then we see the window of opportunity. When you have that wide open mind, the world is wide open and is such a wonderful place for us. Aneka vaktranayanam, aneka adbhuta darshanam, aneka divyabharanam, divyaneko dyutayudham, divyamalyambaradharam, divyagandhanulepanam, sarvascharyamayam devam, anantam visvatomukham. Tomorrow onwards, try to see and appreciate the beauty in the floor which is cleaned by the janitor, the bathroom which was cleaned by the house, the maids, the housekeeping folks, or an IV which was just started so meticulously by a nurse, or the tape which was taken out without hurting the patient. See the beauty in every aspect. And the Lord says, I am all this, but I am the death also. Kalosmi loka kshayakrut pravruddha, lokan samahartam iha pravruddha, rite pitvam na bhavishyanti sarve, evasthita pratyanekeshu yodhaha. And this is the verse quoted by Oppenheimer after the experiment of the atom bomb. Those of you who have seen Oppenheimer, we will talk how it was projected in the movie, but this is something he quoted, you can see in YouTube's. So after saying this, Arjuna is trembled. Then Lord comes back to Arjuna and says, Mate Vyadha, don't worry, be happy, put your effort, then you shall see the success. Nimitta matram bhavasavya sachin, you be an instrument in my hand. And after all, we are the instruments in the divine hand. We know that even the most successful cardiothoracic surgeons, interventional cardiologists, the surgeons, all they know that there is a divine power within them, driving them, propelling them. Dhiyo yo na prachodayat. One of my friends, he always says that before doing any procedure, he chants this Gayatri Mantra. So that prachodana, that propelling power is within us and behind us and all around us. So you can worship that with name, with form, without name or without form. With faith, Shraddha. We'll come to that in the 17th chapter, which deals with Shraddha. So to know is great, but to practice, to preach, anyone can preach like me, but to practice what we preach, what is preached, is great. But ni mere practice without knowing the utility of it, the essence of it, the usefulness of it, is mere practice is not enough. So we have to contemplate on that. What is it for? What am I doing this for? So that dhyana. Then after that, as Rajaji has said, this bhakti, knowledge and karma put together, you know that it is not just one person's effort. Most of the time surgeons take the credit, but see the anesthesiologist, how much of role he plays and how many others who play the role preoperative, postoperative for the success of surgery. When there is knee replacement successful, we all just, you know, praise the orthopedic surgeon. But see how much of teamwork involved. So that karma phala, we have to surrender unto the higher consciousness. Shreyo hi jnanam abhyasat, jnana dhyanam vishishyate, dhyanat karma phala tyagaha, tyagat chantir anantaram. And I shall
recording in progress.
I shall complete. Two to three minutes. So this one verse, one of my friends used to say that his teacher said that. Adveshta sarvabhutanam maitrakkaruna evacha nirmamo nirahankaraha samadukha sukakshami. Hate none. Be friendly to everyone. And go beyond I, me, myself. Mine and my own, and from ego space to eco space. So that is when we develop this personality where we are not afraid of anyone and the world is not afraid of us. Yes, manno dvijate loko, lokanno dvijate chayaha, harsha marsha bhayo dvegaihi, mukto yas sachame priyaha. This is my devotee, O Arjuna. Not the one who wears tilak, not the one who wears the silk robes, not the one who goes to the temple every single day. Yo na hrishyati na dveshti, na shochati na kangshati, shubha shubha parityagi, bhakti manya same priya. He is the bhakti man, he is the greatest devotee, O Arjuna. And that is how this 12th chapter ends. And these are 8 great pushpas we should offer at the feet of the Lord. And the first and foremost of those flowers is ahimsa, non-violence, physical, mental, verbal, ahimsa. and Indriya Nigraha, and so on. The eight pushpas are mentioned. So Bhagavad Gita is a chapati yoga. Chapati yoga, as one of our teachers, Shista Garu, used to say. The flower is karma yoga. The water used is bhakti yoga. The fire upon which chapati is made is jnana yoga. And the time it takes is dhyana yoga. And it is like a prism. One merges with the other. Through one, you can see the other. And the base is dhyana. The apex is that supreme consciousness, the superpower. And you can reach through any of these three paths. And I shall stop here with this quote. Each soul is potentially divine. The goal is to manifest this divinity by controlling nature, external and internal. Do this either by work or worship, karma yoga or bhakti yoga, or psychic control, dhyana yoga, or philosophy, jnana yoga, by one or more or all of these, and be free. This is the whole of religion. Doctrines or dogmas or rituals or books or temples or forms are but secondary details. Om Tat Sat. Thank you.